Hello, welcome to Yahweh Christian Broadcast. I'm your host, Elkie Brabble, and I'm so thankful to have a wonderful friend and guest, the powerful in Jesus, Miss Misty Wetherington.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. It is a blessing. This is the first time I've had you on the show.
Yeah.
I've been meaning to have you on for a while, but the timing had to be just right.
Yes.
But Misty, you are a youth pastor, a children's ministry pastor, so to
yes.
speak, at Groundbreakers Global Church in Kinston, North Carolina.
Yes, yes.
Correct. And how long have you been their youth minister?
Gosh, since 2016, I believe.
Wow. So
yeah.
that is several years.
Yeah, yeah.
And it comes with blessings and challenges, I'm
Absolutely.
Sure. Yes.
Absolutely.
Well, I've been attending Groundbreakers, and I have been really enjoying my time there. And have seen these children interact with you. And it's just so obvious that you adore them and they adore you.
Yes.
And you can just tell that it's not just you. You have a passion for these children.
I do.
It's seen, it's known, the kids know it. Because you and I know that kids know when the adults are faking.
Absolutely, they do.
They know when something's real, when it's authentic, and when mm-hmm. it's not real.
And they're quick to call you out on it, too.
Yes, they will.
They know, and they will tell you.
Yeah.
They will tell you.
What was that saying? It says, if a friend tells you you're ugly, they're jealous. If a relative tells you you're ugly, you know, they might have a beef with you. But if a kid tells you you're ugly, you're ugly.
Yes.
They'll say, Miss So-and-so, why do you have a mustache or a chin hair? I'm just like, hadn't your mama taught you any better?
Right.
We can't see. We don't have our glasses on. We don't know what's there. But kids, they can hurt your feelings, but they can love you so good.
They can. They really, really can. And, you know, sometimes when we ask for prayer requests in children's church, they tell all the parents' business, all of their business. There is nothing that is a secret. The children's pastor knows everything that happens at your house.
Isn't that something? I remember I felt so threatened at preschool when I dropped my kids off at preschool, and the teacher says, we promise you that we will never tell you what they say about y'all. And I thought, oh, my goodness,
yes.
I am history. Because there's no secrets, are there?
Nope, not one, not one. They tell you when they get spankings. They tell you when mom and dad might say something ugly.
Oh,
and
yeah.
They tell you everything. So
gives you a reason to pray
yes.
in your prayer closet.
Yes.
I bet you have one story after the next.
Plenty of stories.
Yes,
very
that could keep
many.
You entertained for hours.
Absolutely.
But you are God has put you in charge of a generation that's underneath your
yes.
care. To sort of shepherd,
yes.
as you will. But if you were to entitle this message today, what would you call this message that you're about to give?
I would call it that there's a generation. And I say that because, you know, as I was praying, even this morning, there was like a groan that came out of me from the Lord. It was like I could feel his heart for this generation where we've been slack. We've really been slack in, you know, teaching our children and raising them, you know, in the Lord. And, you know, I think sometimes even when we're in ministry, we can get complacent
yes.
and we can get apathetic and, you know, it becomes a routine sometimes and you're just kind of coasting.
Going through the motions.
Yep, going through the motions. And when I went to the pastor appreciation breakfast at Bethel Church yesterday, the pastor talked about that. He said, don't coast. Don't coast. And I thought that was a great word for him to give. And because many times, you know, we get caught up in the routine. We get caught up
yes.
in our own personal lives. And we forget that this is an assignment.
Yes.
It's an assignment, and that one day we'll have to answer for.
Absolutely.
And so we really have to really be on fire for the Lord and really listen for his voice and what he wants to do in our life to be able to minister to the lives of all these kids, because we're at a time in history where, you know, parents have forgotten,
mm-hmm.
you know, there's a generation that has kind of fell in the wayside,
mm-hmm.
and church and God has not been important to them at all. Yes. And so now we've got kids coming up and we're wondering why in the world is the way it is. And it's because we have not done our part to teach our children. But, you know, the Bible commands us to do that in Deuteronomy 11. Mm. And if it's okay, I'll read that.
Please read that. I was just thinking, it's somewhere in Deuteronomy. Yeah. So please read that.
It's Deuteronomy 11, and I'm going to read from the Message Bible because I like the Message Bible. It's kind of like the Bible for dummies, right?
So Message just tells you like it needs to tell you.
It does. And it says, it's verse 18 through 21, place these words on your hearts. Get them deep inside you. Tie them on your hands and foreheads as a reminder. Teach them to your children. Talk about them wherever you are, sitting at home or walking in the street. Talk about them from the time you get up in the morning until you fall into bed at night. Inscribe them on the doorposts and gates of your cities so that you'll live a long time and your children with you on the soil that God promised to give your ancestors for as long as there is a sky over the earth. And he tells us this because he loves us. Mm-hmm. You know, if we get... let me go back to this. The children of Israel, you know, when Moses was on the mountain and then the smoke was coming from the mountain, they were at the bottom of that mountain and they could see the smoke. They knew God was there.
Yes.
And yet they still built a golden calf. Mm-hmm. And they could see God. Mm-hmm. Yep. And that's how easily we go off track. And so he's telling us, do it all day, every day. Think about me all day long. And when you go to bed, he's saying, think about me, talk about me, teach your children. Remind them all the time that I want good things for you and I will do good things for you. And you have to keep it in the forefront of your mind because we easily go off track.
That's right. It's a command and a charge.
Right.
And it has to be seen at home. I remember talking to a Methodist pastor. I was having children, and, you know, they were like 3 and 1 or whatever, or 4 and 1. And I was saying, you know, I've got to make decisions about their schooling. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, I went to public school. I said, but I'm really concerned about what I'm seeing in the schools. And we're talking, this has been 20-some years ago.
Yeah.
And I was concerned then. And he said, Elkie, let me tell you this. He said, my wife is a principal of a public school. He said, but my kids go to a public school. He said, but it starts in the home. Right. He said, you have the greatest effect on your children because not everybody can afford to put their children in private schools.
Exactly.
So that's why people are doing homeschool. That's why they're pulling them out of the school systems because of some of the things that are trying to be passed down, these new they're implementing these things that are ungodly for kids who have to attend school.
Right.
We won't even get into that. That might be another show.
Yeah.
But he said it starts in the home, and it's something that you model for them. Mm-hmm. And right there is a command and a charge. He's telling Moses to tell the Israelites, you are the one that has to talk. You know, when you go outside, thank God for the beautiful day. When you see a bird, say, look at what God created, this beautiful bird. You start as a baby.
Yes.
And you let them know that Jesus, because of the Lord, we have everything. And they'll grow up with this thankfulness that God created the world. You know, my mom did that with me. And I never, ever, ever questioned the Lord. And it's not like she conditioned me or brainwashed me.
Right.
I never questioned God's goodness because we come to him as a child. Mm-hmm. With childlike faith. Right. And you just know that it's the truth. And you know that you know that you know. But it has to be reiterated with the parents.
Yeah.
Because if they're like, well, why should I serve this God? It wasn't good enough for mom and dad. They've done fine. They've made a good living. They're good people. They pay their taxes. They've never been in jail. Blah, blah, blah. But if they don't have God, if they don't have eternal salvation secured with the Lord Jesus Christ, this life is the best they know.
Right.
This life is the best they know, and they will enter into eternal separation and damnation from God. And that's the cold, hard fact, isn't it?
It is. It really is.
So they could actually lead their kids to Christ, to eternal salvation in him, or they can show their kids how to go straight to hell.
Yeah, absolutely.
People don't want to talk about hell, but it's the truth, and I'm not going to back down from that subject because We love people enough to tell them the truth.
Exactly.
And you tell those kids the truth, don't you?
I do, every chance I get. And it's so funny because we had a lesson not too long ago about being lukewarm.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yes.
And, you know, I told them, you know, what does lukewarm mean to you? And, you know, they had, you know, a little bit of an answer, but yes. I said, you know, it's, you know, you're just going through life and you come to church, but you're not really talking to God every day.
Right.
You're not really reading your Bible. You're not really doing the things God has told you to do. You know, that's being lukewarm. You know, you say you love God, but you're not really close to God.
Yes.
And so after I said that, I said, so how many of you would say you're lukewarm? And everybody raised their hand. I said, oh my goodness. I said, we have a problem. I said, you guys have to understand that we have to be on fire for Jesus. He yes. doesn't want us to be lukewarm. He said he would vomit us out of his mouth. And so, you know, you get all the, ew, you know, yes. kind of thing. But I said, guys, we have to pray every day. We have to read our Bibles every day. We have to talk to the Lord and stay in communion with him all the time. And so we had a little altar call and, you know, everybody repented of being lukewarm and everything. And I had to tell him, you know, last week, I said, don't wait for me to go tell you to let's go to the altar and worship during worship time. I said, I want to see you doing it on your own. You should yes. want to come to church and worship God. I said, how would you feel if, you know, someone came in your house and ate all your food and slept in your bed and never said not one word to you?
Mm,
I said, how would you feel? Good. And they said, well, I would kick them out of my house. I said, that's exactly right. I said, so we can't come in God's house and never talk to him and never interact with him. I said, we cannot do that. So you guys need to make sure that you're going up and you're ready to worship. I said, don't wait for us to tell you. You need to worship before we do.
That's so powerful. You know, Misty, you have successfully, well, you've been doing Bible study, I mean, Vacation Bible School with these children for a while. But for the past 2 years, you've held Vacation Bible School here at the Father's Refuge in Dover, North Carolina. And it's been very powerful out here yes. on the grounds. Number one, lots of prayer goes on here yes. at the Father's Refuge. So I like to say it's holy ground out here.
Absolutely.
Lots of prayer, lots of ministry has gone forth, lots of worship. So I can't think of a better place than, not that your, I mean, your church is awesome. Of course, the same thing has happened there. But on a larger scale of accommodating kids and having more activities,
yeah.
Scott Murphy's been gracious to open the place up. And
very much.
He wants a mighty move of God. And I just love that about him. He just
yes.
wants an authentic move of God, and he's got the place to do it and is willing. So we're very grateful for all that God's doing in him. But tell me a little bit about what you've encountered with having them out here the past couple years and what you've seen the changes in them.
Yes. So our first year was last year, and it was our very first time. So we were a little nervous, you know, about having an overnight camp and all the things that go along with that. You know, it's a lot of responsibility, and then kids get homesick. And we had a couple that got homesick, but mm-hmm. we kind of talked them, you know, through it and everything, and they got through it. But the first couple of days, you know, we kind of went through the routine of Bible school and everything. And that third day, something just kind of opened up and kind of broke open. And the leaders, you know, we were very exhausted and we were just really wanting to go to bed. But something in me was like, that's not what we need to do right now.
Right.
And so everybody went to their cabins and all the female leaders went into the girls' cabin
mm-hmm.
and we began talking with them. And then we just started praying with them. And when I tell you, the Holy Spirit fell in that cabin like I have never seen on children before. It was very amazing. We had girls who got filled with the Holy Spirit. We had girls who had like heavenly visitations.
Wow.
We had girls who experienced deliverance.
Wow.
It was amazing. But what was so amazing as well was as we were over there, see, our boys didn't know anything about it, and
oh.
neither did our male leaders. And so the boys said, one of the little boys, I think he's 7, he said, I think we need to pray for the girls.
Oh.
And they began praying for the girls. So we had extra prayer from the boys, you know, and it was amazing.
And tell me the age groups of what are we talking about age groups?
We're talking about kindergarten up to 12th grade, because we had some of our teens come and help us. You know, they were volunteers. And so it was just an amazing time. It was truly an amazing time. And one of our girls, she said she saw angels around the camp.
Wow.
That night. And what was funny was Scott was telling us, you know, my wife and I pray for there to be angels around this camp. And it just brought him to tears, you know, whenever she told him, I saw the angels. You know, it's just a confirmation, which is always awesome from the Lord. And then this year, you know, kind of the same thing, you know, the first 2 days, you're just kind of going through it. And then that third day, you know, something just broke. Everybody came in the altar room at the camp, and boys and girls, and we began just worshiping the Lord, and it just fell. The spirit just fell. And one of our boys, I got a voice message from his mom, because I was staying in the cabin, and she stayed in the altar room with her children. And she sent me a voice message, and he said that he saw Jesus in here that night. Mm. I was praying for one of the little boys who came. He was 5 years old. There was a chair in the middle of the room, and he said he saw Jesus sit in that chair. And the boy I was praying for, his name was Dominic, and the boy who saw Jesus, his name was Elijah, and he said when you went to pray for Dominic, he said, I saw Jesus get up and walk around the room, and then Dominic came and sat in that chair where Jesus was sitting, and he said, and you started praying for Dominic, and Jesus was helping you pray for Dominic.
Oh, my goodness.
And I just cried, because when I prayed for Dominic, all I could say to him was, Jesus really loves you, Dominic. Yes. I said it multiple times, and he just smiled, this cute little smile, you know, and I really felt like the Lord was helping me pray for him that night, and I shared that with his mom whenever she picked him up, and she just cried, and it was just a beautiful thing, you know. And then that Thursday night, we had Mr. Eddie James come, and he did a whole service with all of our VBS kids, and it was just amazing. We had kids out in the spirit on the floor. We had kids, again, who experienced deliverance, and some who got filled with the Holy Spirit for the first time.
Yes.
And it was just, they just said it was life-changing. And we had a lot of testimonies come in about how, you know, they could understand now how it was so easy to connect to God. And, you know, they had had trouble before, but now they could connect with him easily. And one girl said that the Lord showed her what she was supposed to do, you know, in the future.
Isn't
and so, yeah, it was very amazing. And
that's amazing.
I cannot go back to a vacation Bible school where we only have 2 hours with these kids.
Right.
Because you need that time.
Yes.
If you really want them to have an encounter with God, you need that extra
Absolutely.
Time.
I love, I don't know if anybody out there's listening and you feel like maybe kids are too young to be exposed to all this spiritual stuff.
Mm.
I want to tell you right now, if you've ever seen children in a worship service, and the Holy Spirit, when we say the Holy Spirit falls, it's like the presence of God descends into the room. Yes. And the atmosphere gets thick. That's the only way I know how to describe it. And you feel the weight of the glory of God.
Yeah.
And nobody really wants to move. And this liquid love is poured all over you. And you're feeling the tangible presence of God.
Mm-hmm.
You dare not utter a word because it's so beautiful. It's so peaceful. And I can only say, if you haven't experienced it, open your heart up to experience that. But that falls on the children in the room.
Yes.
And when you see these little kids that are crying, there's nothing wrong with them. They're crying because they're encountering God at this moment. They don't understand why they're crying, but they feel this love that's permeating them and engulfing them. They're never the same.
Never.
They're never the same. They're never going to feel that type of presence from any other human. You can't get that from your mother. You can't get that from your father. You cannot get that from your spouse, boyfriend, girlfriend. It is a love that surpasses your knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And when you see children fall out. You know, people would say, oh, that's demonic. It is not demonic. No. When you see people just fall out under the power of God and the Holy Spirit's all over them and they're crying, it's nothing to be scared of. It is a beautiful thing. Yeah. That child gets up off that floor and he or she is a new person.
Yes.
And he or she has been touched by the Lord and they will never be the same. And they will never ever shake or forget that encounter that they have with God. And I praise God for people like you who will take the time to pour into these kids. Because let me tell you something about Misty. She's a nurse. Yes. You have a full-time job, correct?
Yes, I do.
She's got a full-time. So right there, you could say, well, Misty don't have time to do all that. She pours her heart and soul after a 40-hour work job into these kids. And then on top of that, she does the vacation Bible school. She does whatever's needed. She decorates a classroom, goes over and beyond, and then bakes cakes on the side and decorates. So it's hard to like her. I mean, it's really hard to like somebody that talented. But you have to like them so you can get a free piece of cake sometime. I hadn't tasted your cakes. But it's just amazing how I know it's overwhelming. But yes. You carry yourself with such grace and poise that you would never know that you've got all that on your plate. Because the anointing is on you to do that, to accomplish it, so you just get it done.
Yeah.
And the rewards of that, you know, just yesterday I saw on Facebook where there was Pastor Appreciation Day at the Bethel School in Kinston, which is mm-hmm. a Christian school.
Mm-hmm.
And the kids in your ministry invited you to come for their Pastor Appreciation.
Yes.
That says it all.
Yeah.
So what else would you like to share today?
Well, you know, this is a generation that has had more things thrown at them than any other generation. There's so many demonic agendas that has come against them. You know, they've got social media and and that alone is enough to drive anybody crazy, really.
It is.
But these kids get on social media and they see these things going on in the world, and you know, the world is teaching them that this is okay. What's wrong with this? Because as I said before, we haven't been teaching them like we should. That teaches them, you know, this is not mm-hmm. okay. And so I think that we need to begin to, we've got to get a passion again for our children. We've got to begin to cry out to the Lord for our children against these agendas, for their minds, you know, because it's really a mind thing. The enemy is coming against their minds, and he wants them to think that, you know, all this stuff is okay. And the big thing now is I have anxiety, and they probably do. I'm not saying that they don't, mm-hmm. but, you know, when you hear other people saying it so much, then you begin to take that on as well, and you begin to believe, you know, that you have the same thing or you have the same issue. So I think we need to begin to cry out for our children. But not only that, you know, I feel like the Lord created us because he wanted family.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he created the family, mm-hmm. and the deterioration of the family began in the garden.
Yes.
When, you know, when Eve took the fruit, but Adam said, the woman you gave me, she did this. So he's mm-hmm. blaming God and he's blaming Eve.
Mm-hmm.
And you had Cain killing Abel. Yes. And so the family had already begun to break down.
Yes.
And so really children's ministry begins with the whole family.
Yes.
You know, we've got to reach them all. And, we've got to connect, find some kind of connection and build relationship,
exactly.
you know, not only with the children, but with their parents too. I was telling my husband the other day, I said, you know, I feel like sometimes we need to have parenting classes available, you know, for new parents. And I think there are classes available, mm-hmm. but maybe it should be mandatory. I don't know.
Yes.
But you just see people who, you know, they talk to their children in a not good manner sometimes.
Yes.
And I feel like sometimes they just don't know how to connect with their own children. Mm-hmm. And we see a lot of that. And we see a lot of parents, you know, on their phone and not really, not paying attention. And we got to begin to break those things
Amen.
And connect back with our family.
Absolutely.
And you know, I learned that lesson the hard way. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we can make ministry an idol.
Yeah, we can.
And yeah. And all those gifts and talents, they begin to be used for, you know, the wrong reasons, you know, and you get prideful and things like that. And but we were going, it was when Groundbreakers began, and we had, you know, our youth group interaction. And, you know, we were just going all the time. And I wasn't home, you know, with my husband and connecting with him as much as he wanted me to be. You know, it's okay to go and do ministry, but you got to remember your family is your first ministry, and you got to keep that relationship intact. Or all that you're doing is for nothing.
Yes.
And so,
so true.
We've got to keep our families connected and build those relationships and try to heal the family. 'Cause I think God is really wanting to restore the family right now.
Yes.
So,
yes.
You know,
so we're about out of time. It's gone by so fast, but I believe that in these last days and with this generation, there is a generation, like the name of this message, there is a generation that's dealing with confusion and chaos.
Yeah.
It's all around them. Everything is competing. And if you don't teach your children, the world will.
Absolutely.
And I made it my mandate that my children would learn from me because of what I knew in the Bible before the world got to them.
Yeah.
So if that's you out there, maybe you've taught them from day one. Maybe you're just coming into Christ and you haven't done things the right way. It's okay. God will show you how to do it from here on out. You can, even if you're 70 years old and you've never lived for God and you've just decided to do so, you can still have an effect on your children, your grown children, and your grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Just by you changing to God and doing things His way can affect a whole generation. Amen?
Absolutely.
God will use it. He can redeem the time.
He can.
You're going to have a lot of prayers because, you know, you haven't sown things into the kingdom of God, but it's okay. God will meet you right where you are. So don't feel like it's too late for you. It is never too late.
Never, never.
Well, I want to thank you, Misty, for coming on the show.
Thank you
for all you're doing in the kingdom of God for these children. Thank you for all the families who have benefited from what you're doing with their kids. And I just lift you up in prayer. I thank God for you, and
thank
I pray that He increases you in every way. May His face shine upon you and give you peace and wisdom as you navigate in bringing these children up in the admonition of the Lord.
Thank you.
God
yes.
bless you.
Thank you.
And God bless you. I look forward to seeing you next week.
Yahweh Christian Broadcast. Be a part of helping us go into all the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Text GIVEYCB to 77411. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Text GIVEYCB to 77441 and be a part of helping Yahweh Christian Broadcast spread the gospel of Jesus Christ.
I've never been forsaken. I've never had to stand one test alone. No, no. That's when I look at all the victories and the Holy Ghost power starts rising up in me. And it's the root of my weakness. It's a man. Church, it's a man. Sure. Oh, He never promised that the cross would not get heavy and the human